Doing a lot of travel at the moment as the Treasurer. Fair bit on. Jim Chalmers joins us now from Canberra. Good morning, Treasurer. How are you?
Great, Carl. Happy New Year.
You too. Can you just remind everyone at home when people's energy prices might be going down?
Well, we're hoping to take some of the edge off those price increases. You know, we know that that's one of the things putting real pressure on people. So we've got a cap on gas prices. The states have got a cap on coal prices. And we're also going to give, through the course of this year, some electricity bill relief. I'm working with the state and territory colleagues on that at the moment to try and get that all sorted. So, unfortunately, there will be increases in electricity prices, but what we're hoping to do is take some of the sting out of that, take some of the edge off of that, and that's why we've got those interventions in the market, plus a bit of cost of living relief for your viewers
you
as
seem,
well.
You seem a long way away from the election promise, though.
Oh, well, the commitment that we made about energy prices was that renewable energy is cleaner and cheaper energy. And we said in 2021 that it would be cheaper in 2025, and that, you know, in between then we've had a war in Ukraine, which is pushing up energy prices, as everybody knows, I think, and appreciates. So what we're doing instead, we're taking some pretty, I think, substantial decisions to cap some of these prices and to give some of that bill relief when people get the electricity bill in the mail. And we're hoping that that makes a difference. But it's a big part of our inflation problem in the economy. It's one of the reasons why I'm so pleased that we are seeing now the beginnings of some wages growth in our economy, which has been missing for too long.
How's that energy intervention going? Because from the outside, it looks like it could be a dud. Price restrictions restrict supply. Energy retailers have stopped taking new gas customers while others are increasing prices. Some businesses have been reporting to us they're being forced into more expensive plans. I don't see a whole lot of positives there.
Well, the gas price cap's only been in place for a few weeks now. It came in on the eve of Christmas. And inevitably, you know, people will want some more information as they get their head around what it means for them on both sides of the equation, whether they're selling gas or buying gas. And so there's an appetite for some more information and some more guidance about how it works. And the ACCC will provide that guidance before long. And so, but I think we do need a bit of perspective here. What we're proposing is a relatively substantial thing. We thought through all of the options. We think this is the best available. But inevitably, you know, not everybody wants to have their prices capped. And so there will be a bit of back and forth as we bet it down and people get their heads around it. That's just inevitable.
A bit of back and forth. I mean, some of these companies are giving you a bit more than back and forth at the moment. Anyway, we're talking about worker shortages throughout the last 6 months. We've been talking about that. But you're going to pay those seeking jobs more money. How's that not going to be inflationary?
I'm not sure what you're referring to, Carl.
In terms of paying people more money, who are in terms of job seeker who are at home, you're also talking about the fact that some of these things can be inflationary. How is giving people more money not inflationary?
Well, we don't have a proposal on the table to increase job seeker. You know, there are suggestions being made to us all of the time how we might do that. Well, we haven't come to a concluded view on that, but that's not something that we've put on the table. We've got processes to work through that. We don't have an inflation problem because people on pensions and payments are getting too much money, or we don't have an inflation problem because workers are earning too much. In fact, they've been earning, wages growth's been too small over the course of the last decade. We've got an inflation problem because the war in Ukraine's pushing up energy prices and COVID is putting pressure on supply chains and a few other issues as well around labour shortages. And so our job is to get wages moving again in a sustainable way. We're doing that. Our economic plan is working when it comes to the beginnings of wages growth. We're providing cost of living relief, whether it's energy bill relief, cheaper early childhood education, cheaper medicines, or in other ways. You can do that in a responsible way without adding to inflation. And that's a central part of the budget that I handed down in October, and it'll be a key part of what I do in May when I hand down our second budget as well.
So that's a no on job seeker increasing. Is that right? Because it was a little different before the last election as well, wasn't it?
Oh, look, always, you know, when you're a Labor government and you know that people are doing it tough, you do what you responsibly can, but you've got to weigh it up with the fact we've got $1 trillion of debt in the budget and we've got to make it all add up. And so those are all relevant considerations. You know, on an almost daily basis, people that we respect and like and listen to put proposals to us to increase JobSeeker. And, you know, when we can responsibly do that, sensibly do that, affordably do that, obviously we consider it. But we've got other cost of living relief in the budget already. There'll be more in the budget in May. We've got to weigh up all of these different options and different priorities.
There's a bit on.
I was listening to you talk to Eddie Jones a moment ago, Carl.
I thought you
was
said
talking
Dirty
about
Jones.
The year ahead. Eddie Jones.
I'm glad it wasn't Dirty. Yeah, go on about Eddie.
Eddie Jones. I was thinking Eddie's got a lot on his plate, but I think we've all got a lot on our plate in 2023. You got a new co-host.
Yeah.
There's a new coach of the Wallabies, and there's a bit on for the government as well.
All right. It's a good trifecta to have. Everyone's going to be okay, I reckon. Good on your treasurer. Thank you, Sarah.
Thanks, Carl.
Welcome back. Well, powering our homes and not paying through the nose is an issue facing families across the nation, and it doesn't seem to be getting any much relief. There are suggestions the government's intervention setting a cap on prices may have in fact created a bigger mess, and consumers are, of course, the ones copping it. Joining us to discuss today's headlines is Independent MP Di Lei and 4BC Scott Emerson. Good morning to you both. Di, I want to start with you first. Now, you've got people who are struggling to keep their head above water. How cost-effective will powering their homes be? I mean, the whole situation's become a bit confusing.
Look, I have always maintained that in terms of choices, we have to give people the choices to choose the energy resources. And I think I have said also that the transition period from, this energy to cleaner energy have to take time, because otherwise people can't afford to, especially in our area in Fowler. Predominantly, a lot of people are, struggling with power bills, with rent rises, with interest rate rises. So there's so many issues here in an electorate like Fowler where people are struggling, low socioeconomic background. So electricity prices, energy prices is very important, and the transition period is very important as well. I can't emphasise this enough.
And they're the kinds of issues that would be facing people in electorates across the country. Scott, do you think that the government here has helped or hindered the situation?
Oh, look, last year we saw them do a lot of deals to get this legislation through Parliament, and they were very successful in getting it through Parliament. But this year is when the rubber hits the road, and we'll see how the practicalities are of implementing that policy. Apart from that spider that's coming to get me there.
I know, I thought I was going to bite you on the head there, Scott.
It was. Just like the electricity bill might bite a few people as well.
Yeah. Good segue there, absolutely. I know, well, we all need to navigate through that. Now, let's go to Victoria now. There's this big story that's developing. The planned easing of public drunkenness laws means that those intoxicated in public will now be taken home, or, to quote, sobering up centres. They could also be taken to a friend's home. Anyway, we've suggested perhaps taking them to a kebab shop. Di, police are worried the onus is now on them and paramedics to prevent any risk to the public. What are your thoughts on this?
Look, I think I agree. I think this is going to be a big problem, and I don't know why Victoria did that. I think that, the behaviour of people when they're drunk, protecting the public is very important. So other than Victoria not drinking anymore, which I doubt...
That's not going to happen.
I think that's... that's right. I don't know why that decision was made in the first place.
Well, it was sort of a recommendation that came out of the Aboriginal Deaths in Custody, and it sort of raised a few questions then at the time. What is the solution? So it's a fair enough to implement a law, but if you don't have a proper solution, then you're kind of left in the dark. Scott, do you think that this is in a way wasting valuable resources? I mean, police and paramedics are under so much pressure as it is. Should other people instead be looking after this situation, this issue?
Well, public drunkenness is an issue, and that report did raise serious concerns. But let's look at the practicalities of this. The police don't get involved. Others, AMBOs, paramedics have to deal with drunks. And then they have to deal with violent drunks. Not every drunk wants to be taken home. They want to stay out and keep partying. And then, of course, we're also talking about drunks on there attacking other people on the streets. It is a policing issue. This is a solution raised by a report, but look at the practicalities of what it means day to day. I just don't think this is going to work.
Yeah, it's the practical element of it that's the... That's the tricky part anyway. But look, let's go now to the awards ceremony. We know we're in awards season as it is. Cate Blanchett has overnight delivered a stinging criticism of awards shows in Hollywood just generally, but at the same time accepting a Critics' Choice Award for Best Actress. She's likely to win an Oscar. Di, her comments have left the internet divided. Some are praising the star, but others calling out her hypocrisy.
Look, I love Kate Blanchett, by the way. I think she's a great actress. But I think she's probably has got this utopian world whereby everybody should be, come together and be awarded. And I don't know if that's the case. Obviously, in that industry or any other kind of competitive industry, there's always going to be a winner. Mm. So I don't know. I think it is a very divisive comment, but I can also understand this great, let's acknowledge a group of women rather than just selecting one person. But of course, that's not possible, is it, when you go into that kind of space, in the art world in particular?
Well, of course. And I guess if you look at it, being nominated is recognition in itself, right? And we know that. But this is the very nature of an award ceremony. There has to be recognition for a winner. Scott, do you think it was a bizarre speech to make? Do you think there's any merit to it?
Oh, look, I'm not surprised that Kate Blanchett made this speech. She talks about these kind of things. I guess you'd say to Kate, you want everyone to be equal, everyone to be acknowledged. How about they all get paid the same amount as you get paid, Kate? I don't know if that would be quite the case.
Yes, I'm sure she's very handsomely rewarded. But Hey, look, thank you both so much for your insights. They're always great to chat, Diane Scott. Thanks. Have a great day.
Thanks, Sarah.
Thanks, Sarah.
In our next half hour, Wallabies Bombshell, we're live with newly reappointed coach.